Okay, round three. There are going to be a couple of videos in this, and the reason that I'm making a couple of videos rather than just one long drawn-out video is because, you know, people may want to take a break. There are certain things that kind of wind up a little bit, and rather than bouncing all over the place, I'm trying to get things a little bit more on topic. So there's going to be a couple of different parts of this, plus I can make a couple of videos and just release them over time and get kind of like a backlog going. That way I can get certain things off my chest, you have something to watch, and I can figure out things that are going on with my particular work schedule. Okay? So hopefully this works out well for anybody. Of course, if you have comments, criticisms, questions, we all grow from those. So by all means, feel free to leave them in the comments. And of course, leave a like and subscribe if you like what you see. I try to address any comments that I see. If I miss one, I apologize and we'll get to it as soon as I can. But I'm generally welcoming of anybody, regardless of whether you think I'm a great guy or an asshole. You have full right to believe both. You can hate me, you can like me, that's perfectly fine. Just treat me with respect. That's all that I ask. Okay, so, moving along. Like I was getting, like where I stopped at in the last video, target base. People like Onision, the Onion Kid, movements, cults, political groups. What is their target base? Who do they look for? Why do they look for them? What kind of purpose do they have? Okay, so the target base is usually, for these groups, is largely teens, young adults, people that either have just got into college or just got out of college. Occasionally, they will target the elderly or people that are retiring because, well, you didn't know that. But why do they target these people? Why do these specific groups? Why do these specific classifications? And kids and teens are basically kind of funneled into the same group here. Okay. They always, there's a popular expression that says, always start them when they're small. They're more malleable. They're easy to manipulate, they're more emotional. And these groups, their hallmark is that they prefer emotion. They like to get you riled up. Emotional stimulus reactions, and they keep that going, and they keep that going, they keep that going, until like a Pavlov's dog, it becomes more like a stimulus response. They ring that bell, and you act accordingly. At that point, you're just a pawn in their chess game. And the younger that they start you, the more you are liable to defend them to the death as you get older. That's why they like them the youngest the most. You see stuff that's going on with these causes where they're parading kids around? They're not doing that because they care about the kids' well-being or because they're celebrating something involving kids. No, they're doing that because it's what you call political indoctrination. Cults do it all the time. We just went from religious movements to religious cults to political cults. It's the same basic, same crap, different rapper. Just that the second rapper's a lot more shiny. And they figured they can make a lot of money off of this. Politicians realize, hey, this is something that gets your gaze off of our stuff, off of our scandals. So of course, we're going to pat them on the back. We'll even give them some donations on the side through some of our people, Soros. And you won't pay attention to Benghazi, to the gun running, the drug dealing, the human trafficking that goes on in the country. You won't go on the fact that our infrastructure is shit, that our roads are in serious disrepair, that our school systems are more backwards than they have ever been, and that our colleges went from centers of learning to centers of political indoctrination, where they're trying to tell you how bad white people are, as opposed to what is the history of your country, or how does American government run? Problem. Big problem. But anyway, back on topic. Target base. So they prefer these particular groups because they are easily to emotionally manipulate. These are folks that really aren't going to care so much about facts for the most part. They want it there, they want it now. They will easily take the sniff because it makes them feel important. Remember what I was saying about the thing with lasagna? They'll accept this as lasagna, because, oh my god, someone's giving them something. And they've never had something like that before. Maybe it's attention. Maybe it's your favorite person on YouTube giving you a thumbs up and saying you did a great job. That emotional rush. kind of like a Skinner box, where that little test where the rodent would go after the pellet and, you know, keep hitting things, or the test with the pleasure centers where they would hit the button and get a particular shock that gives them a euphoric sensation. And some of them would keep hitting that button over and over and over again. It's a very similar psychological principle at work when it comes to these movements and how they manipulate people, or how people like Greg manipulate people, because it's the same thing. They say, oh, I love this person, and that person's like, oh my god, I've gotten noticed. And they're so happy with that, that they overlook all the other bullshit. Oh my god, I'm on TV. I'm famous. People at school will be talking about me. I'll be all the gossip at work. Or, it feels so good to be fighting the man. That was a common one that we got in the movement circles. It was just so good to fight the man. Forget the fact we don't know what we're fighting, really why we're fighting, or how we're fighting in a way that's not going to screw us over even worse. But we're fighting the man, and we're Pancho Villa, and we're the revolution. You're full of shit. You're a grown child, and you need a reality check. You may not like that, but that's reality, and your beliefs, as well as mine, are irrelevant. That is about what is and what isn't. And the hard reality is, you're not an activist. You never really were. You don't really care, and you don't really care about these causes. Just another political zombie. But, again, target base. So, they pick these kids, and many of them tend to follow a particular trend. They tend to be follower types. Heavily follower types. Let's see if I wrote this down here. No. Okay, so there are several different types of person. We'll go through like six types. Okay, and one of the first types is just your basic bystander. Okay, Joe Schmo. The person that is kind of curious, maybe even skeptical about how the movement works. So the second person is the second type of person, the type 2, is someone that is basically, they've gotten in a little bit, they've got a taste of it, and like any drug, they're not quite addicted, but they're really kind of gung-ho into things. So we'll call them, you know, just a gung-ho. Third type, this is where things start to get a little bit weird. Because this is where you get a lot. Type 3s are basically hardcore projection cases. They are there because of a personal insecurity. And they are there because they are there what you call the fear-mongering. They're the ones that movements really like because they ensure that you are going to get a lot of money off of these people. As long as they flat out have spoken many times that I've heard, they have said, if they're afraid, we're paid. How do we keep them afraid so we're paid? How do we get a target base that will devour what we say without asking for a lot of evidence in return? Remember the target bases that I mentioned? Combine the right catchphrases with the right emotional manipulation and then plug for the money, and they're laughing at you straight to the bank. One of the most successful scams ever sold. So type 3s are projection cases, largely, or insecurity cases. And you see, the one that I'm seeing the most common when it comes to projection cases as of late has been regarding the whole issue with transgenders. The LGB community, there is a lot of projection there. There is a lot of insecurity there. And I'm not saying this applies to every person member within that group, because there are people that I know in the group that are not like that at all, and going, hey guys, what's going on? But when you have someone in there that says, oh my god, if you're against this, you want this, you want that. No, I don't. Or you hate this because you question that. You are dealing with a type 3, a projection case. They're the ones that usually lash out with the hate and vile and reactive mindset the most, simply because they're afraid that if their cause gets questioned, that somehow it means that they themselves are going to be questioned. They have never bothered to personally and truthfully question their own beliefs. So whenever anybody else does, it puts them into a tizzy, and they can't process anything and they can't handle anything either. A lot of the more vocal people in this community as of late have been like this. Hillary supporters, a lot of the same thing. They do not and will not question their own beliefs worth a damn. You'll see this very commonly. So they're one of the most common. So then we go to type fours. Oh God. Type fours. Type fours are the bullies. Type fours are the bullies that they don't care about the cause. They are just looking into it for money, for attention. They're looking to get into a cause because it will give them a legitimate excuse in their minds to torment someone else. Whoever the cause says is the enemy. A good example of this? Feminists. Feminists that turn around and go, if a male does this to a female, it's bad. But if a female does this to a male, then they are taking on oppression and they're taking on the patriarchy. Rather than the objective truth, which is that no matter who does it, no matter what your gender is, your race, your social strata, wrong is wrong. If you hit someone in the face, it does not matter what gender you are, it is still assault. If you steal from someone, it is still theft. If the very thing that you are doing, you would accuse someone else of being racist, sexist, etc. for doing, then that makes you in general also a racist, sexist, etc. You don't get a pass because you're a part of a cause. And these certain things do not stop existing because you're a part of a cause. So if you're a woman and you're a feminist, you don't... It should not be where males no longer have the ability to be abused. You can't say, well, females can't abuse males. Males can't be abused. Because there are plenty of statistics and evidence that will say otherwise. Black Lives Matter, another good example. You can't cry police brutality and then say, what do we want, dead cops? You can't talk about white discrimination and then practice black discrimination. You can't pick on people just because they're white. You shouldn't disrupt rallies just because they didn't talk about black people. That's not inclusive, you're just being an asshole. Again, stuff like that. So, those are your type... Type 4s? Yes, those are your type 4s. The stealth crazy slash nat... they're your more your... Yeah, stealth crazy. And, they're the more rambunctious one. We'll call them the rambunctious. Type 5s. Type 5s are... Okay, if type 4 was basically what you call your basic fringe, type 5 is your full-on semi-predator. They've gotten a little bit farther in the cult or movement or grouping. They're the more predatory ones. They are the stealth crazy. Because they will smile to your face and they will act like your friend. But ultimately, they are just trying to win you over to their side. And when it finally looks like that ain't going to happen, or you're not going to give them what they want, suddenly out will come the guilt trips. Out will come the lies, the deceit. They'll start talking shit behind your back. They'll say stuff to your friends. They'll make shit up to your friends. They may even target you for harassment or ostracization from your community. I have seen and experienced it, and I have known other people that have done that have had to go through the same. I've fought it off because I know how to fight off these bullies, but other people have not been so lucky. They are predatory, and they can, like most sociopathic types, they can look just like that, basically anybody. You can be Joe Schmo walking down the street, and I had one guy that was like, hey, great to meet you, nice to know you, do this charity thing with me, would you? I'm like, yeah, sure. Then the next, then like not even a day later, I'm saying something about, okay, this stuff they're talking about with China's trade deals are kind of weird, and man, did my feed blow up. You're this, you're that, you're a third thing. All I said was this was weird. What exactly did I say that was different? Was that person ever truly my friend? No. Was this person really a great, upstanding person? No. But if you ask people in the community, I guarantee you there are people that will back them up and say, oh, this person's wonderful. This person's excellent. Salt of the earth, you know, yada, yada, yada. He helps kids on Sundays, etc. Stealth crazy. They build up a facade, and they use that facade to hide behind when they pull their shit. And they don't look at people as friends, neighbors. They look at people like allies, like they're in some sort of constant war. And they'll say stuff like that. We need our white allies, our straight allies. Guys, this is not a war. If you see it like a war, then you need mental help because there is something wrong with you. This is not a war. We need our male allies. No, you don't. You need to sort your own shit out. But you'll see a lot of that sort of stuff, and why I call it stealth crazy is because more often than not, they'll go days, weeks, months, and they'll be trying to build up a case about you, or they'll be trying to, basically categorize all this shit that they believe that you're doing, and it'll be lying awake, and you won't even know. And then one day you'll just wake up, and bam, there's the crazy, and you're like, is this the same person? When did I meet this person? Why is this happening? And what even caused this? And upon further dissemination, you didn't do anything. You challenged a belief, you triggered them, and now they're going to go off on you because you're not a supporter of the cult. And the cult always wins as far as they're concerned, because if you're not with them, you're against them. If you disagree, if you so much as question, then you're the enemy. Everybody has to think alike. Everybody has to be a part of the herd, a part of a cult. Bonus points if they say they're anti-conformist. Seriously? Okay. So, we're going to move on now. There was a sixth type. I'm sorry. I apologize. The sixth type is your full-blown predator. They're usually at the top rungs. But, they're the ones that are basically a mixture of 2 through 5 with a special emphasis on 3 and 4. They don't really care so much about being on the predatory side or doing stealth crazy because they believe by now that they have enough of a following that they can do whatever the hell they want and get away with it. So largely, they're really gung-ho because they have a lot of passion and a lot of energy. And you'll see this out of this. This is one of their many tricks to appear, like, you know, to use their charisma to kind of get everybody going on them. They attract a lot of follower types, a lot of type 2s and type 3s, and then once it becomes more obvious what they're about, and that other people will get away with stuff by harping into their banner, a lot of type 4s as well. The more aggressive follower types that are just kind of looking for a group to belong to will generally start to migrate into type 3 and type 5 specifically. And they love follower types, because follower types almost never question. They want so badly to belong somewhere that they will agree to anything and do anything as long as they are one of the cool kids. But type 6s are the worst of the worst, because they're a combination of basically types 3 through 5. And they have all of the worst features. They think that they're some sort of leader. They're the ones that will try and push into any crowd to kind of make their voice heard. They're the ones that frequently turn peaceful rallies into violent ones, because they want that attention by any means, and they're going to get it, as far as they're concerned. We had one guy that we were doing something for during the Bush day, or the time when everybody was ticked off at Bush, and it was a Hilton, and Rumsfeld was supposedly in the building, and this guy's yelling, "Storm the Hilton!" And I'm sitting there going, no, this is not what we're about. We don't know that the guy's in there, one. Two, what did the people in the Hilton ever do to us, aside from work there and have the bad fortune to actually be working that particular day? Not a bloody thing. Why are we doing this? It'll get us attention. Bad attention. Bad attention. It's still good for press. You're a psycho. You're going to get people hurt and or killed. Yet this particular person, you'd be surprised how many people have their clever pet nicknames for this guy, how many people pat him on the back, talk about him like he's some sort of great upstanding person, and just the look of this guy is like a freaking snake. Very blank face, very glassy eyed. It really is like looking at a snake that's sizing up prey. And you'll note a lot of that from Onision as well. Onision is very much what you would call a, he's a definitely a type 6. Lainey is more of what you would call a mixture between, I want to say she's more of a, I won't say, I want to say type 5 because she's very much the stealth crazy type. Everything that just screams it. You know, there are things that she knows that she is basically okay with. And there are other things that are very shifty about this woman that, again, I've said it before in my Ado in Despair, I really don't think that Greg is the only offender here. I'm really sure that she's also in on it. I would not at all be surprised. But, Greg is very much what you would call a type 6. Which we call, what would be a good term for that one, for a type 6? I don't want to say pariah. We'll just say full-on cultist. He is a full-on cult type. They're very manipulative, they try to be very charming, they like to lead large groups of people and make themselves look good. If they can help themselves to your money, even better, and they will basically take everything they can and leave nothing. Back to Greg, look at how he handles his supporters. He doesn't really talk about them very well, he talks about them like they're crap. This person that I was just describing, I have emails, still, saved, in a backlog, just in case, because you never know when one of these crazies is going to pop and go, well, I know this! Yeah, well, I have proof otherwise. Have fun. He's the sort that, you know, just like this other guy, these guys are all stupid and they're easily used, yada yada yada. And that's the worst part about it. These guys brag about it. And the more they know they can get away with stuff, the more they openly brag about it. Look at Onision. Is he being direct or is he actually bragging to your face and saying, I'm getting away with this and you're not going to do shit about it? That is exactly what he's doing. He is bragging to your face. He is laughing in your face. And he is getting away with it. Which is why I keep saying, you know, start talking lawsuits. Start doing something that is going to get attention. Start doing something that is going to that is actually going to affect him. Because words ain't going to do squat to him. He's just going to laugh in your face and keep on doing it. He may even do worse just to see what you'll do next and whether he'll get away with that too. And then what are you going to do? Make another YouTube video? At some point, this has to stop. And that's one of the reasons that I address movements in this, so you understand that this is more of a far-reaching issue. And that where people like this guy get away with their bullshit, this is the same stuff that allows the fringe elements, that allows our current culture, our current victim culture, to perpetuate itself. This is what we call a universal mechanic, universal consistency, because it is consistent across the board. We see it with Onision, we see it in small movements, we see it in large movements. We see it in how people act and operate around these things. Whether it's a celebrity on YouTube, whether it's a celebrity in movies, whether it is a political figure, a religious figure, etc. Okay. I actually kind of cut in there about how they speak into your back, but there were two points that I was going to address later, which is how they speak about you behind your back and how they view their friends and family. But if you paid attention to what I had to say when it came to type 5s and type 6s, I've basically covered that avenue. So we're going to kind of get past that, okay? Okay. So, excuse me. So I kind of covered a little bit more than what I intended to, but it basically covered all bases in that regard. So we're going to go to the next point, which is, what about the money? You remember in my last video when I was talking about I holla back and then they had 150 plus bucks that was going to, setting up rallies and personal retreats. More often than not, the money that you donate almost never actually sees the cost itself. It usually goes to the people in charge of that cause. How many people, how many movements, their founders are taking fancy transportation, how they are eating nice at nice restaurants, taking their dates out from Tinder or wherever, on your dime. Would you believe basically all of them? Out of the majority of donations received, only a sliver actually goes to the cause itself, just enough to make it look like they're doing something. Every once in a while, they might write a check to another charity just to give them a nice PR edge. Because at that point, we have what you call the gambler's philosophy. We have that person that's playing the slot machine over and over and over again, okay? And they're losing and they're losing and they're losing. Then they get that one little win. They get excited. Adrenaline goes through the roof. All of a sudden, they are investing their life savings, and they are broke as a joke, maybe even severely in debt. This is how a lot of gambling addictions get started. I wouldn't be surprised if there are many people with gambling problems that wound up in these movements, or attracted to these figures, because it is a very similar, again, psychological mechanic, which is, oh, well, this happened, and even though it's a minor thing, or it really doesn't do anything at all, oh, well, the movement's doing this, and they really are our saviors, yada, 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 and you get that euphoric rush. And we're suddenly supposed to forget that, oh, most of the money is not going to the cause. Oh, they're lying through their teeth. Oh, they're playing the blame game. Oh, they are emotionally manipulating you. And they are openly talking about it. Many of them will. If you listen enough to people within these movements, what I said about them taking Tinder dates, fancy transportation, you'd be surprised how many openly brag about it. That was one of the things that burned me off the movement scene, from the activist scene, was simply, I got tired of listening to their bullshit. It was either that or I was going to start taking a few swings at people, and I am not that type of person. I don't prefer to be. So it's one of those, at that point, I just kind of retreat and start to kind of wonder what can be done differently, and start to put this brain of mine to some actual use. They don't want to do that, so I'm not going to be in the same space as them. I will not be a party to fraud, and I will not be one of those perpetuating fraud. But I will tell you all about it. I will tell you what the real story is, and there are a lot of people, obviously, that aren't going to like it. I expect to get a lot of heat and flack for what I'm saying right now, but quite frankly, they can go fuck themselves. That's probably about the most action that they've actually truly ever done. And we'll get into that when we talk about the catchphrases, because I'm coming to that next. And oh, we're going to have some fun there. Because I'm going to spell out exactly what's really going on with those. But what about the money? So the keynote here, especially for a hollaback, was personal retreats. That means that they are taking an expense. They are taking basically a vacation on your dime. They're cozying up at your expense. They don't care what you think. Because as far as they're concerned, if you ask them about it, they are fighting the cause. They have to, they're doing all this hard work to fight for the cause, and they need a breather. So they need your money to give themselves a nice fancy vacation. Keep in mind that the cause fighting usually is not done by them. It's done by the type 1s, type 2s, type 3s, etc. They're the ones that are doing all the legwork. For all the stuff that they talk about, CEOs and corporations, about, yeah, the top 1%, they are a microcosm of that, because they are the top 1%. They collect the funds. A large part of it goes to them. And if they're lucky, if the people on the ground floor are lucky, they might get a sniff. They're promised lasagna, and they're given a little cap and said, here's your lasagna, enjoy. And if you don't, you're a hater, you're racist, you're whatever term they can throw so they can get rid of you or dismiss you. They'll call you crazy, etc., etc., but so dismissive. You don't know that crazy is so dismissive. Maybe this person isn't crazy. Maybe they know what they're talking about, the environment's a little bit fucked up, and the people in charge don't want to do anything about it except give you a song and a dance and bilk you right to the cleaners. And that's what they'll do. That's what they have done, and that is what they are continuing to do. Every last one of these movements is preying on you. Pick a cause, they're not supporting you for that cause. They're using that cause to prey on you. They're not giving you messages of encouragement and hope, largely. What are they doing? They're telling you should be afraid of this, you should be worried about that. They're coming for you for this, they're coming for you from that, they're taking away this, they're going to take away from that, there is a war on this. Are we noticing a little bit of common tendencies when it comes to these things that they are promoting? There is nothing positive about these positive movements. Love trumps hate. Great. Try showing it sometime. Practice what you preach. None of us do as I say, but not as I do. We need to hold them accountable when it comes to that, but we don't. That's why they're allowed to do what they do. Especially since, oh, well, Obama said this. Who cares? He's a talking head on a platform. It doesn't change the fact they burned down their own town, folks. And nobody seems to care about that, for the most part, within their organization. Nobody cares. Oh, well, it's this, and they're just letting off some steam. Letting off some steam is having a rally. Torching a place is arson. There is a big difference, a very noticeable difference, with a huge impact on the community. And if you're doing things as a whole that burden the community, you cannot claim that you support it, because you are lying to yourself, to others. It's just a lie. It's fraud, especially if you're collecting money to help the community. So, where does what about the money? That's usually what happens with the money. They treat themselves to it, and they see you as basically cash crop. An easily exploited, easily manipulatable cash crop. And the people that are in their employ are little more than disposable pawns who they know will follow them to the ends of the earth because they want that feel good, they want that gambler's philosophy, you know, euphoric sensation. I did this, I'm awesome. No, you're a dude, you stood around and you yelled. You didn't really accomplish anything. Sorry. That's the reality. You really didn't do anything. You funneled a lot of money. You helped funnel a lot of money to someone that would perpetuate the same bullshit and not actually do anything. Which is why a lot of people make excuses, because it's a hard reality for them to cope with. They can't cope with it. They don't want to cope with it. They couldn't even challenge their own beliefs. They're certainly not going to challenge this newly established belief that they have come to, that they're some great person. Nobody wants to believe that really all that time amounted to jack shit. So they make excuses for themselves. Sorry, that's exactly what happened. It amounted to jack shit. So now we're going to get into catchphrases. This is something that I've been saying I was going to do for a while. So basically, I'm going to come into what they say and what it really means. And you hear these very often. So some of these I've talked about before, and some of these I haven't talked about yet. But so the first one I'm going to talk about is personal retreat, simply because I've already spoken on this, which again, it basically what they say is, oh, we are fighting the power and we need a breather. You know, the appreciate my hard work and effort. What it really means is that they are taking a personal vacation at your expense. More often than not, again, these sorts, they really don't do any of the legwork themselves. That's what they have you for. You'll do all the work for them, they reap the rewards, and you basically get left looking like crap and making excuses after the fact. Again, ironically, it's very much like the corporations and such that they claim to usually claim to be against. Especially a lot of these anarchists that like to cling to these causes and say, well, we're against capitalism. Funny, because you're an excellent model for it. So moving on to that, because this is one of their favorite counters for that, fascism. Especially with the anarchists and such, every time you mention something with these guys, usually they're like, well, that's fascist, you're fascist, you're trying to censor this. No, I'm giving you a viewpoint that you don't like. Fascism, what they say it is basically that for whatever reason, the person being accused of it is trying to censor them in some way, that they are trying to browbeat them into submission, etc., etc. What actually is going on here is this is one of the first times that we started seeing where it was like, if you're not X, then you must be Y. Again, all of it very designed for a reactionary mob mentality. That's what it appeals to. It wants to evoke a crowd, so the mob gets worked up, takes you out, dismisses you, and makes them look good. Then they're the victim, and you're the monster, regardless of what monstrous things they've already done. So fascism is a bullshit term, basically. Because more often than not, the people that are crying, oh, that person's being fascist, if you really pay attention to them and how they behave, chances are the real fascists are them. And I can use other examples in there that actually did happen where people questioned a particular person and all of a sudden they found themselves being targeted for doxing, they found themselves being targeted for harassment, suddenly they were a sexist on one end, or on the other hand they had other people trying to dox them. And It all came down to this particular person being challenged, and the next thing you know, that person would face some sort of harassment from one angle or another in the community. Because these guys, especially type sixes, they usually like to incorporate all avenues. They like to control all avenues. There's very much a control freak side. So they like to have all their eggs in one basket. So that, oh, well, I have direct action, I have PR, I have live stream, I have media, I have people in all of these places. And if someone causes me trouble, well, I can get this person from this group and this person from this group to kind of butt heads, and it'll distract everyone. And while I'm doing that, I can have people that are in this group start shit with this person. And no one will ever connect it to me. And they come out smelling like a rose. Then when you try to accuse that person, oh, how dare you pick on that poor innocent person. Yeah, innocent my ass. So fascism. If you want to talk fascism, look at the social justice warriors. They want, the only opinions they want are their own. Fascism. And if they don't get what they want, then they're going to be bullies, they're going to be hateful, they're going to cause harassment, they're possibly going to threaten people. The very things they often accuse other people of. By definition, that is actually closer to fascism / tyranny. But this is often something that you'll hear them scream over and over again. And if you ever hear them screaming at that point, screaming such things, that's when you need to start taking a look at every last one of their behaviors, because they're trying to sucker you over. Okay, so we've covered fascism. The next one is one of my favorites. Solidarity. You'll hear people preach, solidarity, solidarity, solidarity. Bullshit. Solidarity is supposed to basically, exactly as it says in the tin. They want folks to be united, one big united front that works together in a positive means to basically create change. That is what solidarity is supposed to be. Supposed to. Basically, what solidarity honestly means, as far as they're concerned, is you agree with everything that we say, you don't question it, and if you do, see the fascism point. You are suddenly against us. You're not thinking with us. It's basically their version of a herd mentality. Bonus points if they're anti-conformists. Because that's exactly what it is. It's conformity in a different packaging and flowery phrasing. There is no such thing as solidarity in any movement. As I just went through with the six different types, there are six different types of people within these movements. There are a lot of factions, and one thing you'll often see is, in order to try and not get called on their bad behavior, a faction will break away and go, well, I'm an umbrella group. We'll throw that in there as another catchphrase, because it's one that gets tossed around a lot. I'm an umbrella group. And then, once they've done their little bit of bad behavior, because they want the resources of the whole, they'll then reattach themselves and say, oh, well, it was just a splinter option from a rogue faction, etc., etc., etc. We're really okay now. We've streamlined and reorganized our situation. Flowery phrasing. They're blowing smoke up your butt. And they're lying to you. Because they separate them temporarily so they don't look like they're connected with it. And then it just goes back and they go back to leeching resources and all that good stuff. So solidarity is bullshit. There's no such thing. That's basically saying they want you to conform to their garbage, and if you don't, you're going to pay for it. So we've covered solidarity. So we're going to talk about the next one is going to be inclusiveness. You ever heard the phrase all-inclusive? Or you need to be more inclusive? Yeah, basically it's saying we need to welcome all parties to the table. That was originally the goal. Welcome all parties to the table, equal footing, you know, equality, fairness, firmness, etc. That's what it's supposed to be. What it turned into, what it actually was. Whenever we had problem people, and we were saying, you know, these people are parasites, basically. They're leeching off of our time, attention, etc., and they're stealing donations. They're making things harder to do, not easier. We need to remove them. This is when you often hear inclusiveness the most, and the buddy system pops into play, which is basically, Joe has been called out on something, really bad behavior. Fred is a buddy of Joe. Fred automatically backs up Joe and says, "You're all this, you're that, you're a third thing. How dare you say something about my friend?" And then he whips up his friends, and at that point you have everything splintering off. You see a lot of this, because how dare you question my friend? Like somehow being the friend of a particular person suddenly makes them beyond reproach. Or being a celebrity or a political figure makes them above reproach. People are people. There is good and bad in them. There is no perfection in me, there is no perfection in you, there is no perfection down to the guy down the street. People are capable of both good and evil. People screw up, people make mistakes. People do good things, but people also do bad things, and they should be called out on those bad things. And if you think, like the fans of Onision more often than not, that because he is your little idol, but he can do no wrong, or everybody is just picking on him, then you need to get yourself back in check, because you are lying to yourself. And you need to figure out why you are lying to yourself, and why you are so attached to something so poisonous. Most don't. I've known plenty of good people that have known plenty of really, really bad people, really ugly people, but they will defend them constantly and let them get away with their stuff and even argue in their favor. In many cases, this might even, down the line, lead to that person doing some very illegal, very nasty things. If someone is highly abusive and you make excuses for them, if there is a woman that is beating up her man, and he's just basically taking it, and you're making excuses for it, that could lead to a potential problem down the road by you not saying something. In those cases, are you really their friend by allowing the bullshit to continue? And the answer is no, you're not. You're not any kind of a friend, you're just playing the buddy system. You're just trying to do just enough to get that pat in the back, to look like you're doing the right thing. But it's a lie. Stop living a lie. So, inclusiveness. We saw this with the homeless community a lot, because there were people in the homeless community that were really nice and really helpful and just wanted to improve their lot. We also saw a lot of aggressive panhandlers, drug dealers, and so on, and every time we tried to budge them, we were told we weren't being inclusive enough. When the gangers came through, we were told we weren't being inclusive enough, and we needed to let them do as they please. But inclusiveness. And as you're starting to see, while these things are supposed to mean one thing, they're often used for something entirely different. They're not going to tell you this, because if they do, they're going to see their donations dry up, which means that, unlike the rest of us, they may actually have to work for a living, and not just collect like a parasite off of somebody else. And while some people do have their heart in the right places, a good portion of these are heavy-duty parasites. Vampires of a different flavor. Okay, so moving along. Next up. This is another one. Awareness. 9 times out of 10, if you've ever come across a movement, if you've ever talked about a person, they are raising awareness. Raising awareness. Anytime you come back to them a month later, they will be raising awareness. It is another one that's basically what it says on the tin, trying to get your attention about a particular cause or issue. What it actually winds up meaning. Basically, it is a placeholder. It is a placation. Just enough to placate you to where they can collect more of your money and deflect any of your more pertinent questions about the situation. They don't honestly know what they are going to do to fix the problem. I'll go back to the feminists here, something that they have themselves have stated, which is that there is no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, this is a fight that will never cease, and that everything is problematic, everything is sexist, etc., etc., etc. Now, when we dissect this a little bit further within the realms of reason, there's a big problem there, because they're basically telling you, yeah, we're full of shit, we don't have a leg to stand on, we don't know what we're doing, but we are going to collect your money and call it a cause. And hey, patriarchy, gotta get that blame out there somewhere. Forget the fact that we don't know what we're doing, we're going to blame it on the patriarchy, because a scapegoat is always very, very convenient. Okay. So, usually awareness tends to be a little bit of a hallmark to finding a scapegoat choice, but in the last 50 plus years, it's always been awareness, 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 awareness. Come back months later, I guarantee you'll hear the same thing, awareness. Basically, when you start hearing that, you need to start asking and pressing more questions, more pertinent questions. Probe. Find out what they are doing besides awareness to address the situation. What are their long-term plans? Not just their short-term plans, their long-term plans to getting this taken care of. What do they intend to achieve? How do they intend to achieve it? What do they need to achieve it? If you start hearing the blame game pop up, you know this is a person or cause to avoid, because they're going to bilk you out of all of your money. They're going to play you up emotionally, and they're going to get you just like the other, you know, type 2s, 3s, and 4s. You need to go back to being a type 1 or type 0, which is you've removed yourself from the situation. That is the best way to deal with them. Don't give them what they want. Let them die. Okay, so we've covered inclusiveness, personal retreat, solidarity, fascism, awareness. Okay, so the next one we're going to go to is a new world is possible. This is another one they like to say. Another world is possible. Another world's possible. This kind of goes back into the awareness because it's a placator. It's a placeholder. It's enough to make you go, oh, wow. And it creates a hook to kind of reel you in. A lot of these things are segues. Like, it's an opening statement. If you've ever heard of anything from any kind of a sales pitch, that's exactly what it is. They're snake oil salesmen of a different caliber, because they're looking to create a sales pitch. Okay? They want to get you reeled in. They want to suck you in. Because the deeper that they draw you in, the more money they're going to get out of you, the more resources they're going to get out of you. And it means that they'll never have to work a 9-to-5, because why would they do that when they have your money to do it for them? So, another world is possible. Mind you, usually whenever it comes to this, if they do give any description, it's generally some sort of flowery utopia where everything's magical and there are rainbows and bunnies and sunshine and everybody loves each other. Translation, there was no reality incorporated into this whatsoever. And it just kind of a wake-up call to how divorced from reality a lot of these groups are. Or a lot of these salesmen are. Okay, they want you to buy that swampland in the Gobi Desert. And if you tell them that it's not there, well, then you're just a hater. See how that works? Do, do, do. Very simple, very efficient, very streamlined. But predators are usually tend to be such. We see it in nature, and we see it in society. Civilization is just a different form of nature, just a little bit more savage. Interesting, isn't it? Civilization is the more savage of the two. I digress. So another world's possible, but they don't tell you what that world is. They don't tell you how you're going to get there. They just want to wow you with the visualization. Because if they can plant that seed in your mind, and they can plant a picture in your mind, and paint a pretty picture for you, they can draw you in. So that's a new world is possible, which a new world generally is possible. We just need to figure out what that is and how you want to go about it in a way that is not actually worse than the one we're already dealing with. But you'll never hear that from them, not realistically. Okay, so this one I touched about in a previous video, person of color. And I have a field day with this one simply because you have, in one hand, colored persons, which is considered a racist term. On the other hand, you have person of color, which is supposed to signify them in some way, but it's just flipping two words around and adding up. That's it. Colored person, person of color. It's the same basic term, just with more flowery phrasing. When you start hearing people throwing that around, these are people that you can tell are probably associated with groups like Black Lives Matter or certain other affiliations of that nature. And you can usually tell from those people that they probably are just a little bit, if not really, really racist themselves. Those are usually the people to back away from very carefully, because they will be looking at you like you are either a potential person to use, or someone to use target for harassment down the line. Because if they target you for harassment, then the rest of their cause pats them on the back and tells them what a good job they've done. Great job being an ally for the cause. You targeted that person for harassment. Doesn't matter whether they did anything or not, but now we've achieved awareness. See how that works? See how they kind of join one to the other like that? Right. These are the tricks and tools that they use to lie to you, to swindle you, and to basically take advantage of you on all levels. And they're going to keep doing it as long as you allow it. And it's not just about movements here. Celebrities do the same thing. Political figures do the same thing. Onision does the same thing. It's a universal constant. Universal consistency. We see it across the board. You'll hear that term from me a lot, because it just applies across the board objectively. So, person of color, it's based just basically another racist term designed to make them look important, but it basically reveals them for who they are. And on that note, we're going to go to the next one, which is diversity, which is another word for basically another form of segregation, in a sense. It's a racism of a different term, because anytime you are promoting someone basically on the basis of race alone, that is racism. So, if I turn around and promote a person or give them a special trophy just because they are white, that is racism. So why do we do it for black folks? We have to give them a trophy because they have a particular skin tone. No, that is racist. But we suddenly have to give a group their own History Month. We have to give them their own special television network. They have to get their own special scholarships. And yet they will never say, they never like to talk about how that actually makes them racist. Because they are creating a separation solely designated on the basis of a skin tone, of a skin color, of a particular race or ethnicity, if you really want to get down to it. So, which segues into the next term that I have for us, which is privilege. This has always been a trope term. It's supposed to be how white people have more benefits, etc., than a black person, or so on and so forth. And they like to throw this around. Actually, you'll see this from a lot of white social justice warriors with the whole white guilt narrative. And usually those types will be in the type 3, type 4, and type 5. Especially type 3 and 4, because there's a lot of, you know, guilt types that are heavily in the projection. There's also a lot of type 4s in that look at this as an excuse that they can beat up on somebody or be a jerk to someone and say it was because they were racist. They weren't racist. You're an asshole. Very simple. Privilege. And again, listing what I did before when it came to diversity. When you have a group that, based on their skin tone alone, can get scholarships, can get more, a higher chance of getting a job or an education as far as a scholarship, or looked at as far as getting into universities on the basis of said ethnicity or skin tone, when you get special awards just for being of a particular color, you kind of throw the whole privilege thing out the window, because you can't say that this group gets privilege over you, because if anything, you've demonstrated the opposite. They don't get a special award for being white. They don't have their own, you know, white movie award. And don't say, oh, it's Hollywood, because Hollywood's taken on various incarnations throughout history. Well, throughout what history it's been through. Movies, film, etc. Do not tell me that when you have something like affirmative action that gives them a better chance to be looked at for employment to fill a quota based on skin tone, in favor of that skin tone, that white people have a better advantage than you do, because you are a freaking moron. Okay. So we've covered privilege and the joke that it is, and the people that support this stuff are usually among the white guilt narrative. And pretty racist themselves. I've seen it. I've seen a member of my own family that's done the same thing. Oh, well, you don't like you question privilege, so you're racist. No, I prefer logic and reason. I don't flip out when a child actor that's connected to an IMDb page, whose mommy is in the Democratic Party, suddenly starts talking shit and suddenly hearken to that like it's the coming of the Messiah. It doesn't work that way. I prefer logic and reason. If you want something, actually give me facts. Currently, the facts speak against you. Let's see, equality. Same basic principle. It's usually, whenever they're getting something, then it's for equality. If they're told no, then suddenly you're against it. Keep that one cut and dry. Especially since this is dragging on a little longer than I expected. Harassment. This is another big one. This comes back into what I said earlier when it comes to fascism and how it's okay for one group, but not okay for another. If usually when they're questioned, then suddenly they're being harassed. We saw this with Gamergate, when suddenly they were being harassed and supposedly there were all these threats and stuff that never actually happened. For those of you that actually look into that stuff, you'll see the FBI looked into it and found, guess what? Nothing. Not a darn thing. No harassment. The threats were false, and they lied. But they were questioned, so they were being harassed. Will Wheaton, his wife, was saying how she was being harassed online by naysayers. So I went and looked, because I was curious as to what these things were that were being said. And since this was fairly recent, I would be able to get an objective look and say, okay, you know, is she being harassed? These are just people that disagree with her opinion. Anybody that remotely disagreed was labeled a harasser. And you use that term, and it becomes emotional phrasing. And I call it emotional phrasing because it is phrased deliberately to trigger an emotion on your part that exudes all logic and reason and gets you from a logical state of a critical thinker into an emotionally reactive state with a mob mentality as a reactive mindset. So from there, you're just going, if then, oh my God, it's harassment. We need to do this. We need to do this. This person's evil. And they just react without even going, did this person actually say anything? Okay, no, they didn't. Again, a difference, big difference, between false truth and objective truth. What you want to believe and what actually happened. So going back to the whole, beliefs are the same, beliefs are equal, no they are not. Find better arguments. Okay. So we move on harassment. I would talk about free speech, but basically it's the same basic bag. Free speech is something that's supposed to be for everybody, but it's only their speech that's often allowed. Because free speech, whenever it's an opinion that they don't like, often quickly gets translated into hate speech. So I'm including two terms into one there, because basically it's free speech if it's what they're saying. It's a hate speech if you're saying it against them or questioning their beliefs. Or causing them to question their own beliefs, because heaven forbid they have to get off their lazy butts and do that. So really, that's going to be about it for this particular video. It's almost drawing on to an hour. As much as I would like to split it up, I'm just going to leave it as is. Again, if you liked it, leave a like and subscribe and all that stuff. If you have any feedback, leave that accordingly as well. I do plan on getting some other stuff that may not be quite as political. I like to talk about a variety of different things. So I may talk about the Mandela Effect and a few other things like that next time around. I'm trying to build up a base of kind of things that I can do and say. So it may actually be a couple of days before I release the next video, maybe another week or so. But I'm going to try and get some more videos out accordingly. I'm just trying to kind of get a feel for this a little bit more, reach out a little bit better and a little bit more consistent in my topic, so I'm not really beating around the bush, and get an idea of more stuff I want to do on this channel, because I really would like to do some more Let's Plays, and I very well might. So that's everything for now. Have a wonderful day, and I hope your 2017 continues to be awesome, or if it's not, well, I hope it only gets better. Bye-bye.